The title of the talk is rather intriguing, Sepsis in India. Given the breadth and the vastness of this topic, that is beyond the scope of this 20-minute session. So I would largely restrict myself to sepsis in Delhi. I take your liberty. I largely restrict to talk about sepsis in Delhi. One can argue that Delhi is not only the capital literally, but also figuratively for all sepsis-related mortality. Nevertheless, I would highlight some key geographical differences if there is some evidence. And for sepsis in Delhi, I would largely provide the results of our study, Delhi Neonatal Infection Study, Dennis collaboration, which is basically a collaboration of four major hospitals in Delhi. So that brings to me the second disclaimer. So I am only one of the wheels of this large 70 odd members collaboration. And I'm not, it's not my work, of course. It's I'm representative of a big network. So with that disclaimers, I would rather move on to the topic proper. What I will try to do is, I'll try to answer basically five broad questions. How much is the burden of sepsis in India? So I'll talk about the incidence and the case fatality rate. What causes sepsis in India? So basically we'll talk about the pathogens, the common pathogens, and are they different? And when does sepsis occur? Basically, I'll talk about early onset versus late onset, the key differences, and where does the sepsis come from? So it's a vertical transmission or horizontal transmission or both or neither. We'll talk about that. And finally, I will end up with how we are going to manage. I will concentrate on diagnosis, and that has implications for the next part, which is hugely relevant now, that is antimicrobial resistance. So with that, I'll talk about the first one, the burden of sepsis in India. So this is what we gained from the Dennis study. So the results were published from the inbound three sites in Lancet Global Health last year. So this is what the study flow looks like. So basically we followed about 90,000 odd live births, and we enrolled 13,500 newborns who are admitted in the NICUs. So that becomes our enrollment criteria. And roughly one third of them developed infections, and 1934, we'll talk about that incidence later, they were diagnosed to have sepsis at the end. So if you look at the characteristics, the mean birth weight was 2,200 grams, which is much higher than a typical unit in the West, or most advanced units, if I can call. And the mean gestation was 36 weeks. Again, so these babies were relatively mature and relatively heavy. And if you look at the incidence of sepsis, it's 1934, that basically it boils down to 14.3% of all NICU admissions. In other words, one in seven NICU admissions had any sepsis, either culture positive or culture negative sepsis. 40% culture positive and 60% culture negative of this. And if you talk in terms of live births, it translates to 24 per 1,000 live births, which is slightly lower than the NNPD figures, which is, of course, more than a decade old. That is 30 to 39 per 1,000 live births in a different NNPD. And if you look at the case fatality rate, the CFR, that's about 25%. That means one-fourth. Every four babies who developed sepsis die. And that is different for culture-positive sepsis and culture-negative sepsis. I will talk about that later. And when you talk about the outbound unit, this is another study. This is accepted for publication in PLOS One. This is a single-center study. And the numbers are really phenomenal. If you look at the prevalence, so we are talking about the prevalence here, outbound unit. So the prevalence of sepsis is 54.7. That is more than half of all babies admitted in an outbound unit had sepsis. Fortunately, the case fatality rate was low, so only 10%. And if you look at the other sites, this is the data from a systematic review published in BMC Infectious Disease. So they provide the data from Sundaram et al. From PG Chandigarh. So if you look at the early onset sepsis and late onset sepsis. Early onset sepsis is roughly 20 per thousand live births, and late onset sepsis is roughly 10 per thousand live births. So essentially in India, it seems to be, we are looking at a figure from 25 to 40 per thousand live births. How do we fare when we talk about a Western unit? So this is the culture positive sepsis, that is 10 per thousand live births, culture positive sepsis incidence among the inborn cohort. And if you look at the neonin data, that is the data from UK, the NICUs of UK, so that is only 3.9. So the burden is definitely threefold higher, at least threefold higher. But remember, our babies were more heavy and more mature. So broadly, the burden in NICUs in India seems to be 4 to 10-fold higher than a typical unit in a developed country. So what about, is it true across the sites? If you look at the individual differences in the sites, the total sepsis varied from 11 to 19%. So there is a heterogeneity across the sites, and this is much more reflected in culture-positive sepsis. There's a data, there's in one site, it's only 4%, and it's in another site, it's about 10.5%. So there is a huge heterogeneity. It's not the same across the board. So there is significant heterogeneity, and that calls for the research idea one. So there's need for a national network that has a network of all the NICUs in the country, major networks at least, the NICUs at least, with inbuilt benchmarking and QA initiatives to learn from each other and to implement the best practices. The next, going on to the next, the profile of organisms. So this is our data. So from the inborn, we have about 1,000 cultures, and the most common organism was Acinetobacter. The next one is Klebsiella, followed by Coagulase negative staphylococci and E. coli. So these are the three, four common isolates. So Acinetobacter has replaced Klebsiella and has become the new king, if you can call. And if you look at the outborn, it's entirely different. The most common organism is Candida. Of course, if you look at the different species, there's a different picture, but as a genus, Candida was the most common organism. Remember, 90% of these babies came from some other hospitals and had been exposed to at least 3 to 5 days of broad-spectrum antibiotics. In most units in Delhi, I'm not sure about others, the first-line antibiotic has turned out to be meropenem and vancomycin, unfortunately. And that is reflected in being the most common organism being Candida. And the other organisms were Klebsiella and Acinetobacter. So the gram-negative organisms still hold forth. What about other sites? So this systematic review quoted two studies, one from Chandigarh, and here again, non-fermenting gram-negative bacilli, basically Acinetobacter and Burkholderia. That's a common, so basically I combined the data for both early and late onset sepsis, and closely followed by staph aureus, and of course Klebsiella. That is from Chandigarh. And if there's the other study which is quoted in this systematic review, this is from Pondicherry, from Jipmer. So here, Klebsiella was the predominantly common organism, 2/3 for Klebsiella, and followed by coagulase negative staphylococci. So there seems to be a permutation combination. So between Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, staph aureus, and cons, and possibly E. coli. So there seems to be number one and number two, different centers, there seems to be different number one organism. One common underlying fact is that at almost all the sites, GBS, group B streptococci, is rarely isolated, less than 1%. Now, of course, there are some data from Northeast as well as from CMC Vellore that GBS is relatively common, but not across the country. So that brings us to the next idea, why the organisms have to be different at different sites. So how can we examine the causes of different organisms at different sites? Why at one site Klebsiella, why another site should be staph aureus, and one site should be Acinetobacter? Now, moving on, when does sepsis occur? Early versus late. So this is the data which I mentioned. So if you look at our data, early onset sepsis is 60%. So 60% of all sepsis was early onset, and 40% was late. So 60% occurs early. But if you look at the pathogen profile, that's a different tale. So this is, on the x-axis, we have the days of developing sepsis. So day 1, day 2, day 3, until day 8, and beyond that. And on the y-axis, we have the profile of organisms. So it's a stock bar. So if you look at the bottom, the blue bar, so that is Acinetobacter. And on top of that is eclampsia. So grossly, even though there are some minor differences, grossly the pathogen profile is uniform across the day of onset of sepsis. So the distinction which we routinely employ, early onset versus late onset, possibly is blurred. It's no more relevant. And that has huge implications for the source of organisms, and of course for the treatment and other purposes. But look at the source of organisms. The early onset versus late onset is essentially to identify the source of organisms. If it is blurred, then what is the source of organisms? And that brings us to the next point. Where does these bugs come from? Now, no difference in pathogen mix between early onset and late onset could be because of two major mechanisms. One, the metal genital tract itself is colonized with the so-called nosocomial pathogens. Or there is ultra-early horizontal transmission of the so-called nosocomial pathogens to the babies. So it could be because of either. So let us examine. So if you look at the age of onset of neonatal sepsis, this is from our data. So roughly 60%, as I mentioned, is early onset sepsis. Of these, 40% occurs within 24 hours. So overall 25%, or 40% of all early onset sepsis occurs within the first 24 hours. The remaining 60% occurs in the next 48 hours. So if it occurs within the first 24 hours, then is vertical transmission the key mode of transmission? So we looked at the risk factors of sepsis. So we had early onset sepsis in 713. These are culture positive. Remember, these are culture positive sepsis. And we didn't have neither culture positive or nor culture negative, or these babies were ever suspected of sepsis. Those become the controls. We did a multivariable analysis. And what we found was interesting. There were 9 factors that were found to be significant on multivariable analysis. Of that, 4 were the perinatal factors, traditionally considered to be the risk factors for early onset sepsis. And if you look at the adjusted odds ratio, it varies from 1.14 to 1.7, not much, not even twofold. On the other hand, we had 5 neonatal care-related factors. And there's 4 were completely related to the neonatal care, like CPAP or mechanical ventilation. And the adjusted odds ratio was much higher. It varied from 1.7, 1.8 to 4.6. So that brings us to the question, is horizontal transmission or ultra-early horizontal transmission more important than vertical transmission? Remember, these two have significantly different implications for practice. You have to contribute, you have to focus on the obstetricians, or you have to focus on our own practices. This has implications. So that brings us to the third research idea, to examine the source or the transmission of sepsis. Of course, we need a collaborative research with the microbiologists and the basic scientists. When you talk about how do we manage, so if you look at diagnosis, we always talk about the gold standard being culture, but is it really gold standard? So when you look at the case fatality rate of culture positive sepsis and culture negative sepsis, the case fatality rate of culture positive sepsis is almost 50%. That means 1 in 2 baby with culture positive sepsis dies. But the culture negative sepsis is completely different. It's only 8.8, less than 1 in 10 with culture negative sepsis baby die. Why this is so different? The case fatality rate of culture positive sepsis and culture negative sepsis, why it should be different? What does it mean? The huge difference means, is culture negative sepsis really sepsis? We do not know. If it is sepsis, is it bacterial? Why it can't be viral? Or why it can be something else? And if bacterial, is it because of its less virulent bacteria or less dense bacteria because the number of organisms are less? We do not know. So in other words, are we really diagnosing sepsis? So the wrong diagnosis brings us to the issue of misuse of antibiotics. And that has implications for antimicrobial resistance. So if you look at the antibiotic use, so this is the denominator is all who are suspected to have sepsis, 4,400 odd neonates. 44% of them develop sepsis, and only 1/3 of them, of these suspected of sepsis, did not receive antibiotics. 44 had sepsis and received antibiotics, justifiably so. But 25% of them turned out to be no sepsis, but still received antibiotics for a duration of 2 to 3 days. And in the culture negative sepsis, again, 25%, we do not know how many of them really had sepsis. So we need a rapid, accurate, reliable point of care diagnostic for sepsis. Otherwise, we'll be misusing antibiotics right, left, and center. And that will lead to antimicrobial resistance. And if we look at antimicrobial resistance, this is the data from the inbound cohort. On the x-axis, we have the organisms, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter, E. coli, Pseudomonas. If you look at Klebsiella, the MDR stands for multi-drug resistance. Roughly half of Klebsiella isolates were multi-drug resistant. 80% of Acinetobacter isolates were multi-drug resistant. This multi-drug resistance is rigorous definition. So that is a lot. So 80% of them, even the rigorous definition, had multi-drug resistant. E. coli was slightly better bug than the other two. And if you look at the gram positive, the highlight is 1/4 of Enterococcus isolates being resistant to vancomycin. And we had about 7 bugs totally resistant to colistin. If that happens in the next 5 years, we might have to close our NICUs. And what about outbound cohort? It's much, much, much more damaging. So 80% of Klebsiella isolates were multi-drug resistant. 90% of Acinetobacter isolates were multi-drug resistant and ESBL positive. And E. coli was again slightly better than the other two. What about other studies? Grossly, if you look at the ESBL positive rates in Klebsiella, it varies from 27 to 87%. You can say a median of about 50 to 60%. So really, it's a time to press the panic button. And this, we did a molecular typing, why these bugs are resistant. In Klebsiella, 81% of this our isolates had NDM1, the New Delhi beta-lactamase. And Acinetobacter was, the NDM1 was less, but indeed it was carrying the other resistant gene, which was OXA23. So this is well known by, this is a review by the UK agency on antimicrobial resistance, published in 2014. What it predicts is that by 2050, AMR will take over cardiac causes, cancer causes, and other causes, and it will be the number one cause by 2050. It will lead to about 10 million deaths by 2050. And as usual, India would be the major contributor. How we are going to prevent the multi-drug resistance? We need to prevent infections. That seems to be the key. And of course, we need an accurate diagnosis and appropriate treatment. Without these, we'll be left with nothing to treat. So we need simple bundles, we need hand hygiene, we need to standardize our cultures, we need to find the accurate point of care diagnostics, and we need appropriate treatment. We need basically an implementation research to have an antimicrobial stewardship program. I'm not sure how many of us really understand what is ASP, the principles. It looks very high-fi, but of course, it's not so. We need to demystify antimicrobial stewardship program, and every unit in the country has to have an implementation program. Implementation research is the need of the hour. So this is one step which we do at AIIMS. So we have developed an antibiotic policy for the whole department, and we have a formulary authorization. So the whole department, if I have to start colistin, I cannot start as a unit consultant. I have to call the HOD, that of the department. And for some antibiotics, I have to call the unit chief. So this is essential. Make it immediately. If you are not practicing now, make it right now. And we also have an Android app for the junior residents so that they don't start antibiotics, whatever it comes to their mind. That's important. So key messages, I think I have already mentioned my research ideas. I don't want to highlight again. So I have mentioned the ideas from where the money comes from. So one major funding agency right now seems to be the DNDI. So this is for neglected disease. It's funded by Gates Foundation, and it is UK. Right now it is funding a major study, NEO-AMR, and many of the Indian sites are going to be participating in that. And for transmission dynamics, ICMR, if you're interested in doing transmission to identify the source of organisms or transmission dynamics of neonatal sepsis, ICMR has a huge funding for that. This is definitely, you can get it if you have a good collaboration with the basic scientists. And with that, I would stop. Thank you.
Shown that case fatality rate between the units is almost 4 times difference, 10 versus 40. And you also shown that similarly 4 to 5 difference in between culture negative and culture positive. Did you adjust for the center for culture negative and culture positive?
No. That data is overall. We didn't adjust for that.
So if you have adjusted for center, do you think it will be different, or do you think it will be, will the center affect more or the culture positivity affect more?
I need to look at the data. I have not.
Because that will help us to know whether it is a practices which are leading to mortality or which is the bug which is leading to mortality.
Possible. The supportive care is possibly more important.
Dr. Chawla.
Yeah. Thanks to you for a nice talk. Looking at the prior probability of sepsis, especially for some subgroup of babies and some centers, do you think we'll have a sufficiently discriminating diagnostic test which will bring the probability of sepsis to such a low level that we will, there is no need of giving or ruling out sepsis is possible?
Yeah, right now it's hypothetical, but we should be thinking on those lines. We need to find beyond, we need to move beyond procalcitonin and IL-6 and these things. We need to move beyond something drastically different, like looking at LAMP assay or something like a lateral flow assay. It should be a microbiological based or based on like 16S RNA or something beyond that. We should not be looking at a marker. So it's possible, but if you don't think, it will never be feasible at all.
But I think it will be too presuming that all sepsis which has come in first 3 days is horizontal transmission, because it then you rule out any research in vertical transmission, which is actually needed. One should not assume that it is coming from our environment only.
Yeah, that's a focus I want to highlight. So it is, of course, 40% of these infections occur within the first 24 hours. But that does not necessarily mean this early onset sepsis that occurs in the first 24 hours is horizontal. Right now we are planning to do a study in which we enroll the mothers and then doing a molecular typing and then looking at whether the source of organisms is from the horizontal or from the vertical. We'll try to correlate environmental cultures and mothers, not only with just cultures, but going beyond that metagenomics. That's the next step.
Professor Kriplani, please. Yeah.
Jeeva, first of all, fantastic talk. Thank you for summarizing the data of 70 very hardworking individuals. My question really is, in the range of the priorities that you see as possible, you include better diagnostic tools. You know, there's been a lot of effort on developing high-tech solutions. Yet at the pivots, at the end of your equation, as it were, you put low-tech, relatively simple things. How would you partition $100 between all of them?
Of course, I'm not an economist. Possibly one-third for high-tech and two-thirds for the low-tech. I'm not sure.
Is ampicillin still using, sir? Ampicillin?
No. The third generation cephalosporins itself gone, but I don't think ampicillin is more than 90 to 95%. If you look at the NNPD data, 90 to 95% of the bugs were resistant to ampicillin.
Gentamicin?
Which one?
Gentamicin.
Gentamicin. It's interesting. It's possibly, I do not know, I'm just speculating, it's their sensitivity is possibly coming back. Sort of, I would say, it's roughly, if you look at the NNPD data, it was slightly low, but this data, it showed about 50% of many bugs, that's most isolated, most species, were sensitive to gentamicin. I'm not sure whether it is coming back, but roughly 50%.
Okay, one last question from my side, Jeeva. You said outborn babies, Candida is the most commonest organism. I mean, it's very worrying because you see the gestationally, your cohort of patients was 36 weeks and above and 2.2 kilos and above. I mean, you would expect it in an extremely low birth weight situation, but any explanations for this?
No, we don't have an explanation. That gestation and the birth weight which I showed was for the inborn cohort. But the outborn cohort, almost the same gestation birth weight. So that's what we highlighted in our the paper on PLOS 1, that even though we routinely teach that it's very low birth weight infants who are at risk of invasive fungal infections, here almost everybody had actually invasive fungal infections were more mature and heavy. So we do not know the exact cause, but possibly the broad spectrum antibiotic coverage could have been the risk factor.
So I'm Dr. Usha, I'm Professor of Pediatrics. Sir, I would like to know, how was the diagnosis of culture negative sepsis made in these studies? Whether any procalcitonin test was used or...
We used sepsis screen in which we had a CRP, micro ESR and the counts. But of course, this is the highlight of this study is that the clinical course, we relied a lot on clinical course, not only on the screen. So at seventh day, the principal investigator, the co-PI, they label the baby as having sepsis or not based on the clinical course, the presentation, and sepsis screen, X-ray, and everything put together. We didn't do only procalcitonin. We didn't do actually procalcitonin at all.
Thank you, Jeeva. Thank you so much.